weeks in there till okay. Vignesh joins. Okay.
Fine. Fine. Yeah. Okay. Sir.
Are you able to see this?
Yes, sir. Visible.
Let them watch this.
Yes.
The educational experience, the engagement of the audience has always been terrific. I wish I could be there with you, unfortunately, and circumstances.
Foundation thank Dr. Martin de Leon, Greg Stone, Sushil Kodali, and Ajay Kintane profusely for the ongoing collaboration and continued support and education. And we once again thank all the colleagues across the country, both cardiologists and cardiac surgeons, for participating in these meetings and making this plan success.
Karthik? Hello? Hello. Vignesh?
Sir, good evening, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, good evening. I think you open camera and start off. Other doctors have joined all.
Okay? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Good evening, doctors, and good evening to our faculty, Dr. Shiva Sumar. Welcome you all for this module. Hello.
You have two devices open with you. Recently.
Yes, sir. Yeah, 1 minute. Is that fine, sir, now?
Yeah, but...
Yeah. Sir, good evening, doctor, and welcome to the eighth module of our Cardionics program. And our faculty, Dr. Srinivas Kumar, is with us. And this is a program which we have, it has been focused on the intervention cardiology topics. And as we have discussed, this is going to be a 1 year program. And we would expect more and more doctors to be part of this program to learn the newer techniques and other things our faculty is discussing. And now I would welcome our speaker to be there and initiate this program. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, good evening. Thank you, Vignesh and Micro.
Thanks,
and
sir.
Thanks to all my colleagues who have joined. I hope there'll be more people joining in, but the topic of this discussion is very important and apt for all of us. That is about something to do with STEMI interventions, which is very important. I hope you are able to see my slides now.
Yes, sir, visible.
Okay. So, good evening again. We'll discuss regarding STEMI interventions, what is the management guidelines, what is the change which has happened recently, and some new data which has come up with regarding the culprit and complete, and how to assess and multivessel PCIs in the setting of acute MI, and some new trial data has come. I think we'll also play some Kahoot. I was told that many of the doctors like it, that interaction with Kahoot, so I'll also try to focus some questions at the end. And with this, I also requested people, if you have any doubts or any sort of angio pictures you want to play from your end, we would make that doctor co-host, and then probably you can also present if any of you younger colleagues are interested to show and discuss some in this forum. I encourage that, and I request doctors to come prepared next time. Brings best wishes from Apollo Hospitals. Then the FACS Professional Service colleagues, I'm proud to present this. I always keep telling this in these tough times, and also in this for rendering multiple services regarding, especially in the primary PCI in multiple hospitals, also this model works very well. So each of the hospitals, suppose the hospitals actually do not allow totally working in multiple places, but if it can be done, one primary rota can be done, and we can reach the hospitals in about half an hour's time and provide wonderful care in all the hospitals. But anyway, said that, and at least in Apollo Health Services, we hope Apollo Health City, the primary PCI services, are much better now. So this in the process, when you people were not there, I did play this, but if you want, I'll again play this for you. And this gives you introduction of the TCG meeting, what you see. Please watch this for a minute. Started in 2010, now we can get a full tradition of it.
Hospitality, the quality of the educational experience, the engagement of the audience has always been terrific. I wish I could be there with you, unfortunately, and circumstances.
Whoever has attended, they like this concept of showcasing the entire live cases on the big screen. Not many people attended, but whoever went, they had a thrilling experience. And the live case operators also are thrilled to see themselves on the big screen.
Hi,
what I wish to do is not only in the cadence group, in all the groups, I'm presenting all these live cases with live case learnings, message, giving important messages of each live case coming to all of you, and then weekly one live case will share and also upload in the TCT India site. This is very useful for
you. PAX Foundation thank Dr. Martin de Leon, Greg Stone, Sushil Kodali and Ajay Kirtani profusely for ongoing collaboration and continued support and education. And once again, thank all the colleagues across the country, both cardiologists and cardiac surgeons, for participating in this meeting and making this grand success.
Our CardioNext program is also there as one of the knowledge partners. Whatever important programs we did, I kept them as partners, pick up some of the important aspects in, from the each program and try to accumulate and make it in this important meeting of patients. The response was quite good actually, 5,500 plus, in fact 5,600 and Micro and all other companies also helped a lot. With this, I think I will stop here and then we'll go to the next regular things. But coming to back to the agenda, what we tend to discuss is briefly present to you the earlier guidelines of 2015. Now, what are relatively new changes, new recommendations which has come in 2017. And this is actually ever-going process, ongoing process as the new data comes. I think now new recommendations regarding the flower trial will also come in the coming guidelines. And I'll present you the various case scenarios that could be actually learning for all of you. And suppose when a patient of acute MI comes with single vessel disease, no problem, straightforward, we will do angioplasty. But sometimes young people especially will find tons of thrombus. And then whether to just give lysis for some time or just give heparin for some time, then bring the patient back, or you act then and there itself. And which are the subsets of patients in which we have to stent immediately, which other subsets can be left to medical management. This is again important decision. We became wiser recently with the role of imaging coming up, OCT usage in the acute MIs, AAS and ACS scenarios. I will share some case example with you. And then sometimes the patients present very late and come in emergency situation, gets into cardiac arrest scenarios. In that scenario, so then what are the methods we need to follow? I said as resuscitation to revascularization, I'll share you one or two case examples on that. And then after that acute stage, and some patients come with the stabler stage, but will have multivessel disease. The multivessel disease, then how to approach that patient with a single altogether or a staged PCI, when do you recommend doing everything together? Such sort of things we will present to you in an approach to multivessel PCI. Then a little about acute MI, though we wish that COVID should go away, we don't want to discuss too much about it. I'll briefly cover any modifications we have proposed and we are doing in this COVID era, and conclude in the end showing some of the important aspects. So agitation, if time permits, I'll also show brief glimpses of 2021 conference, which you have seen and which many of you must have experienced already. Coming to this 2017 guidelines, hope I am audible and slides are seen. Vignesh?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the 2017 guidelines, which came, this the left half of the slide shows the 2012, and the 17 is what is slight modifications. Initially, the data was just coming with the radial, though it was like a class 2AB, and then it strong data came with matrix saying that radial artery is the way to go. Which decreases the complications, and then that's how the strong radial route became the route of choice. That is, they said you have to preferably use that if possible, and that became green. So previously we used to think in acute MI situations whether we have to do it. Give me 1 minute. Acute MI situations, whether we can follow the radial or a femoral, many people used to argue that we lose a lot of time in the acute MI accessing the radial, but I think all of us have become comfortable. In fact, the hematomas and chance of having problems would be much less in the primary PCI situation. That's undoubtedly, now I think nobody has any doubts in usage of the radial route in acute MI now. We have reached that stage, fortunately. And then earlier they used to say that acute MI thrombosis is more common, avoid deaths. Yes, that was sometimes happening in primary, earlier first generation of deaths, which had little more thrombogenicity like Cypher and Taxus. But the latest generation stents are quite safe, no thrombosis happening. Actually, in fact, the polymers are thrombotic resistant, inert polymers. So definitely death is favorable even in this. A lot of new trials which came like examination, comfort, AMI, North stent, all that proved. So this became green. So this is class one indications now. There is no doubt of usage of radial axis and regulating stent in STEMI interventions. Complete revascularization is a strong no-no before, the class 3 indication saying that you should not do it. But with the advent of PRAMI, DYNAMI 3 and CULPRIT trial and finally the COMPARE acute and complete trials came showing that complete revascularization now from the class 3 became class 2A, that is a change to LO. Thrombus aspiration, which is supposed to be class 2AB indication, now became class 3. Said that total and test did not show much benefit. On the other hand, it increased the stroke rates and follow-up, but that's how they said class 3. But I'll show you some examples where it could still work. It has to be individualized, and in patients, you know, there is a full thrombotic burden. I feel sometimes still it helps doing a thrombectomy in these patients. And then bivalirudin, which was hyped a lot, and it was the indication, then it was totally green. Now with some negative data coming up, again, now it became class 2. From class 1. Enoxaparin again from 2B to 2A, and early hospital discharge, again there's some positive data coming up with some of the trials now, just recommendation has increased slightly positive. Oxygen was there throughout. Initially they used to say that give oxygen only when there is less than 95% saturation. Now it changed to less than 90%, 95, 94 is also okay. If it's less than 90, probably you need saturation. Tenecteplase place. You can give all patients, especially pharmacoinvasive strategy is okay. And elderly people, probably you can give half dose. That is about TNK-TPA. So these are some of the newer, most important changes which happened from 2012 to 2017. The most important, I would say, is the undoubted indication for radial axis and drug-eluting stents. Then going on to further, not only doing the procedure, but pre-treatment and post-treatment is also important, as we understand. LDL cholesterol aggressive reduction is what is recommended. Initially, we were just putting them on some dose of statin and we are okay. But now the recommendation is to get them to less than 70, now recently modified less than 55. Indian Lipid Association said less than 50. The lower is the better. But how do we achieve it? Initially, they said in improve it, ezetimibe showed some positive data. But PCSK9 inhibitor usage in 4 years showed the such low levels can be achieved. And that is now, again, the class 2A indication. This is in yellow. Complete revascularization would index primary PCI and STEMI patients in shock. Only when the patient is in shock, probably that is class 2A. That is doing all vessels together. The other drugs, like antiplatelet drugs, are also there. Then the CHAMPION trial showed Cangrelor can be used. Cangrelor is just about to be launched in our country. So all of you better be aware of this new data on the Cangrelor, which is coming up. And then switch to potent P2Y2 inhibitors. Initially, it was strong no-no for usage of ticagrelor with lytic therapy. But now ticagrelor has already established itself that can be safely used along with lytic therapy. But prasugrel, still we are a little concerned. And then probably use of polyp pill to increase the adherence was also thought of. So, but the big no-no is previously we used to think deferred stenting. That is, even give lytic therapy or leave for some time, then bring back the patient and get stent later. That concepts what became negative in defer. That's how the defer came. The deferred strategy is not recommended anymore. And then some of the newer things like this Minoca, like normal coronaries with acute MI, all that were also stressed upon. And then time limits regarding it. Time limit, as we know, is 0 to 12 hours is class 1. 12 to 48 hours is class 2A. And patient presents late, more than 48 hours, is again a class 3. But we individualize the patient depending upon LV function, its symptom status, we decide on it. Then electrocardiogram, previously we used to say only left bundle block is important. But now we say left and right bundle block is equally important. And the angiography is indicated if ischemic symptoms come, even if patient presents with RBVB alone. This is again a change. Time to angiography after fibrinolysis. This is pharmacoinvasive strategy is what is recommended 2 to 24 hours after successful lysis. But suppose patient is not responded, unfortunately, in 20% of patients, then you take up as soon as possible. Then these are the some of the other newer things which came. This is a flow chart. I think all of you are aware many of the times. What is more important is the total ischemic time. Right from the patient having the pain from where to reperfuse, that's what is the most important. We need to keep that time as less as possible. What needs to be done is a lot of improvements happened in door to balloon times, and now we are calling it as a door to wire time because sometimes we may not use a balloon. But what is still more important is the patient delays. There's still a lot of patient delays, which factors which are there in this cascade, which education of the patient and the patient coming early to the hospital is very important. Once he presents to the hospital, then within less than 10 minutes, if you're giving lysis, or within less than 2 hours, if you're doing a primary PCI, and the wire crossing should be done in that time. So that is what is the standard recommendations which goes. And then some of the things like all of the cardiologists, most of the cardiology colleagues know this terminology. Then STEMI diagnosis onwards, primary PCI, then when you call the primary PCI strategy, and when you call rescue PCI, rescue is when the fibrinolysis fails, then early routine PCI strategy after fibrinolysis. This is what is generally considered as pharmacoinvasive in our country. That is, you are given lytic therapy, and then the patient, even though he's asymptomatic, 2 to 24 hours within after successful fibrinolysis, you do an angiogram to see what is the status of the vessel and how is the patient behaving. And depending upon what comes out, you decide for the PCI. So pharmacoinvasive actually is both rescue when the lysis works and also when the lysis therapy did not work. So both, we call it as a pharmacoinvasive strategy, either electively doing it or when as a saving measure, you do it. This again shows the target frame lines. From how the patient comes, that's what I stressed upon. Wire crossing should be done within 90 minutes. And then if a patient goes to a center where PCI is not available, then probably fibrinolysis and shifting this patient as soon as possible, and then probably taking care of the patient. These are the guidelines. There's not much of change. But in COVID, they said you probably that some delays are happening, so another 1 hour could be added in the transit. So if you see this carefully, the next slide again shows symptom onset to duration when you're doing. If a patient is presenting from 0 to 3 hours, the primary PCI is class 1A indication. Same is the case with fibrinolysis if the facility of PCI is not there and cannot be done within 2 hours. But patient comes late, 3 to 12 hours, then PCI keeps on scoring better over fibrinolysis. And fibrinolysis only if a patient cannot reach the hospital for primary PCI within 2 hours. There's no change actually in this. It's the same like before. Whereas from 12 to 48 hours, if hemodynamic instability, arrhythmias are there, it becomes class 1C indication. It's in green, primary PCI. So 12 to 48 hours also. But if a patient is asymptomatic and stable, then less recommendation, but we tend to do even here, 48 hours. But what is a no-no is a patient comes after 48 hours, asymptomatic, stable, then here routine PCI is not recommended. What we generally follow in our hospitals is see the patient's symptom status. If patient is young, also see the LV function. If the LV appears to be preserved, then probably we tend to do it because there still we feel some benefit could be there. But if LV is damaged, already thinned out, and patient is totally asymptomatic, there's no rush to do for routine angiogram and PCI. That's what it mentions. Then this is important again to understand that infarct-related artery strategy, that is primary PCI, the infarct-related artery class 1. Then if the patient is developing new, if indicated in the other territories, then it's very critical disease in other vessels, then probably we do that also. Then technique of infarct-related artery, obviously stenting is a treatment of choice. Don't leave the patient with balloon angioplasty alone. And stenting with DES is the choice preferred over BMS. That is, these are all class 1. Radial axis is class 1. That's what I stressed, highlighted before. And then regarding the thrombus aspiration, regarding the procedural details, this is what is said, class 3. But some individualized patient where there is a lot of thrombus burden, we might use it. Deferred stenting is again class 3. Regarding the non-infarcted related artery lesions, that's what we said. If it is a routine thing, we don't do it in the same sitting. But if a patient is in shock, then probably even the other vessels you try to revascularize in the same. And CABG, suppose patient percutaneously, you cannot revascularize. Then only a patient has ongoing ischemia. Then probably you try to send for CABG, but it's not easy to do CABG in the acute sitting. This always to be kept in mind. So if at all it requires a probably culprit vessel, PCI can be done addressing it later. That's what is general strategies followed. Then if you see the antiplatelet therapy, again, the prasugrel, ticagrelor scores over clopidogrel. And then that's how the recommendation said immediately, even on the lysis, now we have data with ticagrelor and clopidogrel. Only when these things cannot be given for some reason, clopidogrel can be given. Aspirin is anyway class 1. GP2BA role is going down, considered only bailout when the patient is not having raw flow phenomena, a slow flow with thrombotic complications, PCI, you tend to use it. And the cangrelor is class 2B indication. And anticoagulant therapy, general usage of low molecular weight heparin or unfractionated heparin during the procedure is recommended. Post-procedure, we do use it less and less common. Then some new data which is presented in yesterday's ESC meeting where the prasugrel scored over ticagrelor are also there. And there are various doses of these drugs are mentioned here. I think they're available. You can refer to. And bivaridin was very hyped before it's again gone down therapy. This is again important. The culprit vessel in only multi-vessel PCI. Now it was thought to be contraindication before. A culprit vessel only we used to do. Now actually there is some new data which has come up. As I said, in the multiple new trials, PRAMIS, CVL PRIT and DYNAMIT 3, we showed that probably the culprit vessels could be done, especially when the patient is in shock type of situation. But even otherwise, stabler patients, now it became class 2B recommendation to include multivessel PCI at the time of PCI. But most of the times, it is staged primary before the patient is discharged from the hospital. We try to stabilize them. Then this is about thrombectomy, we already mentioned. Then other, why thrombectomy became so noise, infuse AMI, taste and total. All of them showed did not no benefit. They also tried to see subgroup analysis. Unfortunately, none of the subgroups also, like anterior AMI, high thrombus burden, also they could not find much benefit. But so many of the times we still keep using it. Clinical practice, we feel it is useful. What about IABP usage in acute AMI? This CRISP AMI trial, we were part of the trial, were the largest recruiters before. What it showed in anterior AMI, whether you use IABP or not, this was, they were congratulating us at that time. And whether you use IABP or not, there's not much significant difference. Death and worsening of heart failure was not different. In fact, size was assessed by MRI was also not different. But the comfort levels of the operators and the procedural hemodynamic disturbances, what is identified in exploratory endpoints, had showed favorable towards aortic balloon pumps. I think with this first 15 minutes, I thought I'll show tell you the principles. And if any of you have any doubts, I think I'll show the case examples, which will make you understand better. Then after that case examples, I can break in between for some time, and we can have some discussion in chat if you want. So some of the case scenarios, what we face is how these patient presentations happens in young patients, how it is in middle-aged and how it is in elderly people, how is it different. Duration, again, as I said, is the most important. Patient comes on time within without much wastage of time. First 3 to 6 hours, I think procedures go well. But only first 1 hour presentations, you need to be careful because suddenly they get up with these ischemic VTVFs. And if you're not geared up, sometimes you could lose patients. So patient presenting very early, as early within 1 hour, you should be always geared up and keep your defibrillators, other things ready so as to tackle and manage fibrillation if it happens. Whereas if patient comes after 10 hours or so, that is the worst period actually to do a primary because the arteries will be filled with thrombotic burdens. So that is the keep it in mind. If a patient actually presents after 12 hours pain-free, then probably what I feel is probably you can give heparin for some time and then let the clot dissolve a little and take up these patients after a day or two. Though recommendations wise within 24 hours we are supposed to see, but at least overnight we can give heparin infusions and try to see whether it gets stabilized. But if the patient has ongoing pain, all these you cannot apply straight away, whatever is the status, whatever the time period, you take up the patient for the PCI. Then
I think doctor have connectivity issues. He will join shortly. Yeah, doctor is joining shortly.
Karthik, are you able to see me?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry for some trouble. I don't know what happened. We'll proceed.
Yes, sir.
Then depending upon the single vessel, multi-vessel, we decide. Sometimes patients present in emergencies. Can I just see the chat once, whether what is the status of other doctors? Just we can see.
Yes, sir. We have two questions in the chat. I'll repost it in the chat.
Hope all of you are hearing me. Can you just respond with thumbs up signs in the chat? Sorry for this some struggle. How to manage case of young MI with coronary artery ectasia and thrombus? Yes. Similarly, young female with SCAD and acute MI. I'll just come to those questions, very important points. I would have shown those. I will take you through these case examples, which I made anyway. So I think if you see this, then this is actually last week it happened. A 31-year-old male is a smoker. This is unfortunate in our country that as India is progressing, then drug history and other things also keep increasing. And as you are alone and they tend to enjoy things, then this is another risk factor, which newer things which were not seen when we were students actually. The smoker, drug history, then came presented as a heavy exertion in gym. And this again, I keep telling that don't try to become Hrithik Roshan overnight. This we need to advise our patients. The heavy gym exercise after 2 hours of everything, he started having pain. 31-year-old male fellow and started having pain. And when he came to the hospital, he had his ST elevations. And this is again thing which keeps happening. When the patient has obvious chest pain and ST elevations, don't wait for enzymes, things like that to come. It is a straightforward diagnosis. And but this fellow was young and patient keeps denying it, don't get yourself confused. And then if at all, if there's a doubt, you can check with the echo showing the regional abnormality again. And then troponins came very high. Then generally, unfortunately, emergency teams get activated. But even otherwise, it was a clear-cut case. Heparin and antiplatelets were given. So pain slightly decreased in the gentleman. See this. Now, the sort of subtle elevations with the history, you need to be careful in picking up. I think there's no doubt in it that a patient has chest pain and they need one. Also, there is ST elevation, V5, V4, V5, V6. Also, there is ST elevation. So, about to go on to V2, V3. So, we need to be careful and address the patients immediately. Then, repeat ECG appeared to be slightly settled the next day morning when we saw we have troponin in young age. We thought we'd take him up for the angiogram and do the knee square. The right coronary, as expected, was normal. And the left coronary, see this. Hope you're able to see this filling defects there in the LAD. With residual thrombotic burdens there in the both in RAO and AP canal views, then the ECG is gradually, when we decided that as a patient is stable and then probably did not have pain at that time, so we would give heparin infusions, probably tirofiban with half dose heparin was given, and then ECG improved and stabilized like this, and slight T wave inversion started coming, suggestive of reperfusion, which is happening in this patient. Then after 2 days, 48 hours of therapy, then when we took up this patient for to cath lab, again, to our surprise, a lot of thrombus is still remaining. So then the dilemma comes whether to address it or whether to leave it. Now that's how the imaging helps us to decide what to do. So we decided to do OCT here. I think OCT runs might take a little time for sake of time. I just focused the freezed images. This is how the OCT is a normal artery. And there's no thrombus in the distal segment, that is normal. Suppose here, if you see, I think thrombus, all of you can make out an OCT. This is a thrombotic burden is what is seen here and the thrombus protruding. And what is also important to make out is the how is the artery plaque material inside? How is the endothelium inside? If you see it, there's a plaque thickness increased. And here, if you see the other layers, also there's a plaque rupture happened and the clot was sitting on that. So if you see the lesion site actually, there's a thickened endothelium there, the plaque there, which ruptures and then the clot forms there. These are the subsets you can't afford to miss it because, again, the arteries, thrombus won't dissolve totally, like how it happens just in a patient with erosion. There is a normal artery like just clot. Then that's how we decided to stent this patient. And another precaution is take a bigger size, whatever the appropriate diameter stent, go up to nominal rather than actually this artery was looking big. So we took a 4.5 stent, one of the less common scenarios where we take more than 4 size stents. 4.5 stent and probably 30 or something was taken. Take adequate length so that the entire lesion is covered, so that the plaque protrusion doesn't happen from the edges, and then nominal atmosphere will prevent it, and then slow flows happening rather than going to very high pressures. So we just went up to nominal of 10 or 12, I think, whatever. And then unfortunately, the artery flow got established very well. We keep saying that both operator and patient has to be lucky to get good results. So that's how then, but we wanted to see how it is looking in the OCT again. We did a post-procedure OCT. This post-procedure OCT, the stent thing from 20 to 40 and this further on, you can see below. As it moves further, I think I will take you through the freeze pictures. This is how the stent struts look very well opposed. There's no gaps, no malocclusion, the circular structure. You can see it. And if you see here in the proximal portion, that's what I was talking of, where there is not much of thrombus, not much of plaque, but a thickening of the endothelium already can be seen in those proximal vessels. So this young gentleman who has a lot of other risk factors could, again, change his lifestyle to address it in future. So then once you do the PCI, the power of it is the patient becomes totally normal, not much of stuttering pain, nothing. And then ECG also gets into total reverse biophysic patterns after revascularization, and he improved dramatically. That's the power of doing a primary PCI straight, and then patient gets discharged within no time. So that's how the OCT helps us in decision making, whether to stent the patient or to leave with medical management. Then this is another patient, sometimes with acute MI, thrombotic burden, incidentally, this some time back, presented with abdominal pain and loose motions. Then he went into, you got arrested in front of the ER. ECG showed this sort of bizarre rhythms. Then once after cardiac shock was given, then ECG showed huge ST elevations that is suggestive of interval MI. So they're confirmed by echo. Immediately, the teamwork helps in this. My junior colleague was there on duty. Then with cardiac massages, we took him to cath lab. Then by this stage, we also reached, and an IABP was inserted to this patient. And it's always important, though data comes negative, don't think that it doesn't help. The patient has no BP and that sort of scenario. So generally, placing of IABP helps immediately. IABP was put, right was okay. Then left again shows huge chunks of thrombus. LAD is actually barely filling, with difficulty filling. See that entire proximal portion is filled with thrombus. And then again, in this sort of stuff, filling defects are all thrombus. Sometimes you get confused with air, but it's not air. It's all thrombosis. Then here, we did multiple runs of thrombectomy, thrombus. And then slight, it improved, but again, it tends to collapse. Other thing which you keep in mind is the other vessel, the LCX, when you're doing sucking from LAD, you always keep a watch on the vessel, prevent the clots getting migrated to non-infarcted vessels. So that otherwise, this is infarcted, that vessel also gets into thrombus, the patient will land in trouble. So that's how I think this appearance looked much, much better. The beauty of revascularization is once the blood flow establishes, then the patient becomes hemodynamically stable, artery improved, and then final, that we thought we may leave it without stenting, and that time we didn't do OCT, that is aspirated thrombus. And this is where critical care also support is very important, multiple inotropes, ventilator initially, and the diuretic therapy, chest X-ray initially showed pulmonary edema appearance. Then with this ECG I saw, then I was reassured that patient would improve. All those ST elevations, bizarre QRBP, everything disappeared. Till that patient did not pay single paisa in the hospital. Hospital managers were worried whether what will happen. And after seeing this, I reassured them the patient will improve, everything will be fine. As expected, day 3, everything was off and the patient was extubated. And then shifted out of ICU. Then he comes for follow-up, he became very thin. Now you don't make out who is the patient. This was very obese. Now this is the attendant who is more obese than the patient. Lifestyle modification is important. I would, for the sake of time, I thought I would break here and show you some glimpses. If you want to, you can just see it. I'll have.
Edition of our TCT India meeting.
Thank you again for inviting me. Thank you.
Behind me, Hendrik.
Which is easy to flex.
It's certainly my pleasure and great honor to open this conference. We have been thrilled and excited to have a collaboration.
It's welcome. I'm keeping the pushing the guiding back.
A very, very good evening and namaskar.
TCT India, South Asia.
Your
hyperkinesis.
Yes, it's like, as a disciplinary, how you can make out?
If you have a device that can being perceived from the arts and the graphs.
Great to see everybody. Mirsam, good to see you too, Mark. Did an RAO shot.
Very good. Again, mid-circumflex district lesion, not very long, not very...
And I appreciate all the patient logins and all the doctors who have participated in this program.
Absolutely wonderful conference.
Congratulate the TCT India 2021 team, headed by Professor.
So with this break, now we go on to the STEMI with multivessel disease. Some stable patients, and then sometimes when the patient present late in unstable formats. And what is the role of FFR versus angioguidance? We'll just try to briefly take you through. This is an anterior MI 65-year-old female diabetic hypertensive dyslipidemia, anterior MI window period of 2 hours in triple vessel disease. ECG shows just evolving ST elevations. Then this sort of thing, when you take him up, already artery neither is occluded and opened up or not totally occluded, but it also has a lesion in the LCX, which looks like borderline. And then if you see the LAD, there's no doubt, very critical disease with slow flow. And then when you check the RCA also had a very critical disease. So now you might tend to get confused whether this is the culprit or that's the culprit, but always go by the presentations, which are changes in V1 to V4, then LAD is a culprit. Then we did initially primary PCO with direct stenting. Then if the lesion is so tight, there's nothing to watch here. That straightforward, then patient PCI happened, improved, and patient improved. The only discussion is whether to address, if that sort of very critical disease, right, you might tend to do it in the same scenario, but there's a calcium there and you're a little worried, concerned to do it in the same setting because something happens there, the patient will land in trouble in a non-infarcted vessel. We thought we'd give some time and brought this patient back. And then immediately after the LAD PCI, revascularization benefits happened, T inversions happened later. We brought this patient back and tried to do FFR to this OM-LCX, which looked borderline. And then now we came data positive that even in acute MI scenarios, you can do FFRs safely. And then that is what is the flower trial, which came in one group of patients. They did FFR guidance, other group of patients, they did only angio guidance. And there's not much of difference in both, but for a little more usage of stents in angio guidance and little less events happening in the angio guidance. But overall, statistically, it was not different, but it is proved that this can be done even in acute scenarios. This OM came negative, baseline was 0.97, after this was 0.88. Later, we went on to address this right coronary artery. As expected, initially, it created some trouble. Then stent was a little underexpanded. Then initially, high pressure post-dilatations were required. This took a little more time than the primary PC, actually. But final result was good, and then that's how the patient was stable. So only LAD and RCA was done, LCX was left out. Then this is another recent patient, I think last 2 weeks back, 72-year-old male presented with inferior wall MI, presents little, though he had pain ongoing since a day, but increasing pain since 5 hours. So when the patient is taken up for an angiogram, I'll take you through, he had a triple vessel disease. The other interesting thing which he had apart from diabetes, hypertension, was known to have a single functioning kidney and old CVA which has recovered. So these are all not good factors for surgeon. You see, surgeons were worried and patient also never wanted. Then that's how we discussed and decided for this sort of presentations. Very critical, critical LCX and LAD disease. The patient presents with actually inferior wall MI. So you see this, the right coronary artery, there is a proximal disease, there is a mid-segment disease, there is a distal disease. That sort of things again make things challenging sometimes, but we need to maintain our cool. Not audible, huh?
Sir, now it is clear, sir. Now it is clear.
Okay. So then the sort of things we should be geared up to do clearly. I think we've decided that RCA was taken up for immediately, probably 3 stents were done. For the sake of time, the stenting was procedures routine. The only thing is the ostial stent placement should be done carefully. and then probably appropriately post-dilated to explain the flaring of the ostium. And this is the final result of RCA, which opened up quite okay. Then in a stage, this is the final result. In between looked like mild disease, but you can't, rather than making totally metal artery, you thought big artery, huge artery again, if you see. And patient's hemodynamics improved and patient became all right. After 48 hours, after checking the creatinine, he's brought to the other stage PCI of LCX, then into OM. That was a post-procedure, and LAD stent again was stented. Diagnosis was protected with provisional approach, and that was nothing much. Then LAD result also was okay. But sometimes you also land up such multivessel PCIs in a shock-like situations, the nights. This is again an elderly gentleman, a 68-year-old male, post-CABG. He was had come with, again, bradycardia, inferior wall MI type situations. Then probably he's going into complete heart block. When we are analyzing also, the block is happening, and then he would degenerate also sometimes to VTVF. Then we put immediately TPI and IAPP was put, and then he was assessed a native TVD. For sake of time, I would quickly run through the native TVD. RCA was occluded anyway before, and then left system also. As LAD, LCX is not filling, sometimes it's a good sign in post-bypass. That means they're filling to BAFTs. Then that is the native vessels. Lima was okay, as we start time and again see limas will be okay. Lima was filling to LAD. It's all right. This is a venous graft. It had a thrombotic occlusion there, which is venous graft coming to the RCA. And you see that is a little more high, big, clear picture. That's a thrombus there. Maybe it got slightly better. This is another leash graft, venous graft to OM. That also has a very critical stenosis. We are confused whether the inferior wall MI, whether it could happen to that or this, then probably we didn't not geared up for the immediately to do filter and all, but acutely patient was in a difficult situation. We decided and did the procedure without filter. Then fortunately everything came all right. But by and large, you should try to use filters in venous grafts if possible. So that was a picture. Immediately the head stentings were done in both the vessels. And then we went on to do for a venous graft to LCX OM. And then that was the result of it. So once the revascularization is done, then patients improve dramatically. That's what is the beauty of it. And then the patient's pressures improved and he never required anything. That's about the approach even in multivessel disease. Recently, the COVID times, I would skip all this for the sake of time. But we came out with a consensus statement. We were writing with part of JAPI with other authors. Then we also now decide which patients to do in what type of scenarios. I think we have enough of discussion since COVID. COVID has come down. So in other words, to say that probably this sort of thing we are not following. But we need to maintain the preserve or even the cath lab staff into picture. And then some of these sick patients where the futile prognosis type of situations where there's not much of benefit, patient already on ventilator and all, there's no point risking everybody's life. That is a futile attempts. But anywhere there is directly, if we can postpone some patients, probably we are doing it. And the patient selection where we could differ, like small MIs and patients with only troponin positives, with not much of LV function abnormalities, and the such sort of things we can avoid if possible. And personal management is also important. We should help our senior colleagues who have diabetes, hypertension, COPD, things like that, older adults, and minimize the cath lab staff exposure also, and preferably to have intubation done before and probably have negative airway suctions, things like that in cath lab. In Apollo, actually, there were the three labs. One, we were designating to try to keep patients who were doubtful patients. I think with those brief comments on this COVID positivity, now I'd conclude saying that we would like to have some time for some chat questions. New recommendations, what I mentioned is basically there's more preference to radial and more undoubted evidence on drug-eluting stents. Thrombectomy, there's negative data which is coming up. Antiplatelets, more stronger antiplatelets are to be recommended. Door-to-balloon time is not what is being followed. Now people say it is door-to-wire time because sometimes we may not use a balloon. And in multivessel scenarios, again, now we have some data coming up that if it's a thrombotic burden, probably if a patient, you have facilities for OCT, you could use them and decide and do some more scientifically. But otherwise, depending upon the clinical hemodynamics, if patient is stable, you try to pre-treat them with some heparin and tirofiban for some time, come get him back. If patient is unstable, address it on the same situation. Multivessel disease, again, culprit vessel PCI is done and the pre-discharge we're trying to do for other vessels. There's also role for FFR assessment in acute MI2. As I've shown in that LCX where FFR comes negative, you could leave it. And these are some of the scenarios, and regarding the COVID and other things I've already spoke. I think we'll stop this year and take some chat questions. And I'm extremely happy. The response of TCT was more than what I expected. 5,663 doctors logged in, appreciated all the live cases. What I wanted to highlight and tell you is I'm also trying to get these live cases to all of you with live case learning messages after the live case and present to you every week one case. All of you can benefit by that format too, I think. I think with this, I'll stop share. And if there's any chat questions, I will take. Otherwise, I'll just briefly play Kahoot because some people wanted Kahoot. And young MI with coronary artery ectasia and thrombus, that's what I already mentioned. If you have the facility, then probably you should decide whether there's a plaque pre-existing. If there's no plaque, if it's only ectasia and thrombus, you can still pre-treat it. But if the vessel already has a thickening of endothelium and plaque there with a suggestion of rupture, you treat it. Then young female with SCAD, again, generally, now with the recent data which was presented in last ESC also showed these patients also have a lot of atherosclerosis, and all the treatment protocols which are to be followed for acute MI atherosclerosis need to be followed. And but if already TIMI-3 flow is there, well established, where stenting may not be required, you can avoid it. But otherwise, the protocols of following should be same, like for any standard atherosclerotic disease. And then I will just take you through the Kahoot, please, Chris. And people want to have some discussion, or shall I go to Kahoot? Can you respond in chat, somebody? I think I will, having prepared, I will just take you through this. And then if time permits, we'll again see. I think now you are able to see the this other.
Yes, sir.
So now I will take you through this STEMI interventions. It needs to be generated. I think all of you who are able to see the screen, you should join
yes,
the Kahoot app with that number. The PIN number is 069-351-60. I think you see it on the screen. 069-351-60. I think Karthik has put it in this chats also, 069-351-60. And then we'll start playing. Ramya, Gopal, and shall we give some more time for others to join? I don't know, many of you are not comfortable, I think, but I was told that you people want it, so I kept it. But anyway, as some more people might be joining. I'll try to keep it simpler for you. Young MI with thrombus, decision to stent or not to stent, decided by angio guidance, intravascular ultrasound, OCT, or FFR. As we discussed, shown the case example also, I think it is clear for you. And whether plaque rupture or is there or normal artery, that's how you decide. I think probably the answer. You must have correct done it correct. The next, we will go recent STEMI with multivessel disease. making FFR was a part of it. FFR was the Sanjo guidance. It was done as the what trial? Food trial, fame trial, beef trial, and power trial. This is very interesting. The label date. This is what I mentioned in between. The flower trial is what is comparison with FFR versus Sanjo guidance. About 500 plus on each arm, and then FFR was useful even in that. But as generally trial data goes, it was not different between angio versus FFR guidance. Angio guidance probably 1.5 stents were average used, and whereas FFR guidance is 1.01 stents. That means less stent usage in FFR guidance, but a little more events happened with FFR guidance. But overall mortality did not differ. That's what is the message of the flower trial. So some of the things which are important also, I thought I would keep in the Kahoot. Thrombectomy, we considered very important before, now it's a class 3 indication as per latest guidelines. Is it true or false? I think many of you know this, now we've also discussed it, but it is like as a class 3 thing. But it has its own role in some patients, we said. Then most important thing which can improve, further improve outcomes of primary PCI. Door to balloon time, door to wire time, ECG to cath lab time improvement, and the patient education presentation time decrease. What do you feel could further decrease to improve the outcomes? Already we had enough improvements in other things. What we thought is patient education is what we need to improve, and the patient presentation time should can further decrease. I think we have one more question. 5 questions we finished. This is the last question, I think. Overall mortality reduction in MI mainly happened because of reperfusion. Obviously, lighting therapy or the primary PCI, that's where mortality is 15-20% in the earlier decades, now increased to 24% in acute MI. So that is because of the better reperfusion method. There's no doubt about that. To make it attractive, I kept it. I think, that's now scoring is basically Gopal has scored, maybe he has answered it fast also. That's how I think he's the top in the list, 3,540. Congratulations, Sai is next, and Ramya is always interested to play this and always participates, our colleague. 735, Swapnil, and many others actually. And congratulate Gopal and others. This is only for to stimulate the process, and it looks like to have some interactive pattern. That's how you wanted it to be done. I took it up. Now we go, I'll stop this and then stop sharing for this, and then again go to a chat of ours before, if you have any doubts, any chat questions if you have, I will take it. I think if there are no further chat questions, then we will conclude here. Some of the scenarios in future also, suppose if you have anything, you can get such sort of thing presentations. We would have again next Cardinics program in the next month. Thank you. And we will stop here.
Yes, we can conclude.
Okay. Thank you all. And we will again meet next month with another important session. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you all the doctors who are joining for the program. And have a good night, everyone. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.